A very good afternoon to all of you, and lovely being here. Great to see so many principals and educators here. And I'm very happy to see that I have a student of mine here and a faculty member from my college also here, because I thought it was important for me to bring this context while I'm talking about how to make elephants dance. I'm sure you all found this topic pretty intriguing. So let's go ahead and see what's the elephant am I talking about? Am I talking about large pharmaceutical companies who are being shaken up by the generic companies in India? Am I talking about large companies that are being shaken up by lean startups? Or am I talking about multinationals being shaken up by Patanjali? I'm not talking about any of those. I'm talking about our own education system. As you can see, the growth of higher education has been tremendous. You can see the number of universities that have come up. When we started, we had less than 50 universities in India. But after the independence and all these years, the number of universities have gone up. If I look at the University of Mumbai itself, today we have over 800 colleges, and we've got a faculty and a leading faculty from the University of Mumbai. I'm sure, ma'am, you remember how few the colleges were when we all started going to colleges. And today there are over 800 colleges affiliated to the University of Mumbai and over 300,000 students who pass out. And in HR College, when it began, it had 24 students, and today we have 7,000 students in these in this four decades. But that's because we are a country of 1.3 billion, and I think the university's challenges are going to be tremendous. So having seen that it has such a big challenge, the student enrollment is going to grow, but I think more dramatically, the enrollment is going to grow because of us being the youngest nation in the world. We have 50% of India's population under the age of 25, and 60% of India's population under the age of 35. And how are we going to meet all this demand? While it's a big demographic advantage, as you can see here, this is a slide that I've been showing for the last 10 years, just to say that India will be the only country in the world which will have a demographic advantage of a surplus of 47 million human resources, which we will produce in 2020, educated human resources. Every other country, if you can see, has a shortfall, including the United States. And I think it's time we should tell Mr. Donald Trump that please don't throw the immigrants away, because you need them, because you're going to have a dearth of 17 million. And then you have China, which was, because of its one-child policy, will have a dearth of 10 million. With so much of all these countries having a shortfall, how is India's 47 million going to be able to cope the demand? Either jobs will come to us, or we will be going to the jobs. So I think all of us here as educators have a challenge that we not only have to produce educated young people, but we have to produce educated, globally competitive young people. And so if you look at this, I think the biggest elephant that I've been fighting all my life is the gap between industry and academia. Everywhere in the world, look at Germany, it starts at the school level. You start doing projects, you start connecting with the industry at the school level. That's why today Germany has the soundest vocational education. Many of the other countries, even UK, has developed many co-op programs with the industry. India is lacking because our academics has always been very concentrated on theory. Our undergraduate has been very focused on just theory. With that, what happens is that we've got so many thousands of young graduates, but they are not employable. And I'm sorry to state again the example of my own university. The Rajiv Gandhi Institute recently put out the statistics which said that only 16.22 young graduates from the University of Mumbai are employable. So there is a big gap, and how is the education system going to cope with numbers? How is it going to cope with this? The second elephant is bridging this gap, which is huge, because we are bringing out engineers, we are bringing out computer engineers, but are they really globally competitive? Also, at least in HR college, I can say, and maybe you all can vouch for this, to say we've been producing managers, we've been producing accountants. We have, when I became the principal, we used to have about under 50 number of students doing chartered accountancy. I realized that for the BCom to become more effective, it was important that I make all the BCom students more and more into chartered accountancy. And when I did that, I'm happy to say this year 822 students have become chartered accountants just from one college. So we produced accountants, managers, bankers, and professionals, lawyers, because they went up to do law. But how long are we just going to create job seekers? We need job creators. And therefore, let's work towards that. That's another very important thing. Are we looking at entrepreneurship? It's amazing. Let me give you this one example. Kushal, do you remember the Chana Singh Wala who sits outside HR college? Okay, we've got a Chana Singh Wala who sits outside HR college. He sells Chana Singh, very creative, entrepreneur. He's been there for many years. Comes to me in the last admission process this year and tells me, "Madam, hum aapka form bechega." And I said, "Kyun? Hamara to bik raha hai na office mein. Kitna queue hai, dekho. Itna queue hona chahiye kya? McDonald's mein bhi 5 minutes se zyada nahi rakhte hain. Aapka queue dekhiye." And I saw long queues. Why? Because there's one clerk selling the forms, right? In every colleges, this happens. In every schools. So I said, "What do I? So kya karna hai? Hum bechega." So I said, "University rules, you know how they are. If you sell even 10 paisa more than what the prescribed form is, you'll be in jail, and along with you, I'll be also in there." So he's saying, "Nahi, hum paisa to wohi lega." So I said, "Tumko kya fayda hai?" I said, "Ek-ek form ke saath hum 2 rupay ka Chana Singh bechega." Right? And I gave him the forms, because I said, if Uber can have the largest taxi system without taxis, why do I need to recreate office staff? He's my office staff, let him sell. And if his Chana Singh does well, it's entrepreneurial mindset, right? This is what we need to get. How can we put this entrepreneurial mindset in our students? How do we develop that? So, I think the difference we have to make now is, this is my biggest elephant again, is the next generation. We need highly employable global citizens that are going to be responsible. This is a real challenge. Some of you in the schools and colleges are doing a wonderful job, but we need to dream. Our dream is we need a very vibrant learning environment. We want to foster creativity, innovation, practice, and research. Our students have become too dependent on books and our whole curriculum. Can we have a university which is challenge-driven and not curriculum-driven? Can we have a university where there are no teachers in the classroom, but outside the classroom?
Can we have these different models? And how can we do it differently?
Yesterday, one of the design students came up to me and she said, "When will we learn creativity through art, actual art that's already there existing?" And I thought, so sad we don't develop something like this. I said, "Okay, the next class will be held in Tao Art Gallery." So we are all going to take the next class to the Tao Art Gallery and do a design class there. I teach marketing myself. And then this young girl's yesterday, her thoughts gave me, I said, why am I teaching also marketing within my four walls? I'm doing a Starbucks case study. I rang up Starbucks and I said, I want to do my class next in Starbucks. So my next class of marketing, when I'm doing the marketing case study, is going to be in the Starbucks. And Starbucks is happy because 50, 60 students, I'm sure they'll have a cup of coffee. They keep having one anyway. So how do we move students from classrooms to communities to careers? But these students here and this faculty here changed this for me. They made it from classrooms to communities and then careers. You don't have to be gray-haired to work for communities. Do it when you're in class and in college and in school. So careers can wait. You'll see this, but they've taken up communities as a big challenge. And how we're moving into that. I want to show you this one video. Is the sound there? Can we have the sound, please?
Mr. President and NDTV, thank you very much for this incredible honor. You know, Malcolm Gladwell in his book, The Outlier, said, who you are cannot be separated from where you came from. I left India 35 years ago, went on to the United States, and had tremendous success in that meritocracy. But none of that could have happened if I hadn't had a wonderful upbringing very much here in India. So I have a lot to thank India for. Now, my three lessons I'd like to share with you. First, please be a lifelong student. You know, when we are kids, we ask questions like, why is the sky blue? Why is the bird flying so high? But for some reason, as we get older, that curiosity goes away. And if we are happy with the knowledge we have, then we are actually going to atrophy. So please remain a lifelong student. Don't lose that curiosity. Second, whatever you do, throw yourself into it. Throw your head, heart, and hands into it. I look at my job not as a job. I look at it as a calling, as a passion. And I don't care about the hours. I don't care about the hardship, because to me, everything is a joy. So whatever you do, please look upon it as a calling and a passion, not as a job, not as something temporary. The third and the most important one, please help others rise. Greatness comes not from a position, but from helping build the future. All of us in positions of power have an obligation to pull others up. You know, as I stand here today, I look at my responsibility not as accepting an honor. I look upon it as accepting a challenge and a responsibility, an obligation to actually make it possible for the people who are younger to come up and achieve levels of greatness, so they too can be on the stage sometime in the future. So thank you again, NDTV, for this incredible honor. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
So as you can see, I think this is our dream, to have the DNA of our students anywhere, wherever they may be, in schools or colleges, to always remain students for their life, all their life, but also passion and compassion. And I think we practice that, and therefore, that was the real discovery for us, because we discovered that most of the young students don't just get challenged by the classroom curriculum, but if you give them a purpose in life, they do get challenged. And at HR College, one of the things, first things we did was, and this is how all this whole generation of young social entrepreneurs came up, was we produced the largest number of social entrepreneurs today, and I'll give you examples of them, and there are examples here who talk about it themselves. And so what we did was we made it mandatory. It's not done in commerce colleges, but we made it mandatory that every student had to do one NGO project in the 5 years that they are with us in the college. And we don't give the degree. The degree comes from the University of Mumbai, but we said we won't give the degree till they've done one project. A whole lot of faculty and a whole lot of staff members said, they'll get you fake certificates. I said, doesn't matter. But if it touches even one heart, look at the heart it touched. This young man from Kashmir, Dhruv, Lakra, set up the first courier company in India today, just received the President's Award for having employed only the deaf. Nowhere else do you have such a model. These young students have now enabled a wheel, and this is going to be the wheel which is going to carry water. I was going to get the student here with the wheel here, but she's been called off somewhere else. And then I'm going to show you something which Kushal was a very, very important person, and he created this revolution in my college, which is still carrying on. And that was one day, a young man comes into my office. I was the sheriff of Mumbai then and the principal of a college, and shuts off all the lights. I wonder, Professor Ms. Chatterji, if this would happen in schools. And I sat quietly, and the lights were all shut off. And I said, why are you all doing this to me? And they said, because we want to sensitize you, the principal of a college. 400 million outside do not get light after sunset. So I said, but I'm doing my job. I'm taking care of this college. He says, that's not enough. We need to sensitize students that they have to do something for the privileged. And so a revolution started at HR College, and this is the revolution. And then I'm going to ask Kushal to come up and say a little bit about this revolution.
It may be the 21st century for the rest of India, but for Mahupada village in Maharashtra, it's still the dark ages. Mahupada, one of India's 70,000 dark villages, areas with no electricity. Resident Vishram Varta has never lived or worked with the aid of artificial light. Even though the government constructed electric poles in Mahupada a few years ago, there is no electricity yet.
We avoid going out of the house at night for water without a light for fear of animals.
But now, all that is changing. A group of enterprising college students is lighting up villages like Mahupada for the first time ever, one solar lamp at a time. Project Chirag, started and managed by students of Mumbai's HR College just 2 years ago, has already lit up its landmark 99th village. Each house gets one fixed and one portable solar lamp. Initially, students contributed 10 rupees each to buy these lamps, but now due to its exponential growth, the project has attracted individual and corporate donations.
See, in a village, if seven students are appearing for a board exam, none of them would clear these board exams. But now, out of the seven people, five of them are actually clearing these board exams.
With no shortage of young volunteers, Project Chirag has already lit up 3,750 homes across four states, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan.
Now kids who've drank kerosene thinking that it's water, so that's not acceptable.
Okay, so I'm just going to stop here and I'm going to give 3 minutes to young Kushal, but let me just introduce him. He was a part of this whole revolution, and then he got selected from the 7,000 students for a scholarship to go to the UK. The University of Westminster gave him a special scholarship, and he did his master's there, and I was hoping he'd come back quickly and again help us out here. Then the Queen picked him up, and he's probably been the only young Indian student from India who has interned with the Queen of England. Kushal, for you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think firstly, it's it means a lot, and it's a great pleasure for me to really stand out here and share this dais with ma'am and share some of my thoughts with you. Means a lot to me. To start off with everything that ma'am spoken about Project Chirag and how, you know, us at college, the students have really taken our learning beyond the classrooms. You know, I'm sure Ameya sir could vouch for this. More than being in his class, I'd love being out there in the villages really helping out these people. And, you know, he's always supported me. So as ma'am, so I think it's been great, right? I think, if I go to recollect one of my really first village visits where I remember we were in the deserts of Rajasthan. And, you know, we had left Udaipur out there, just on a travel of about 40 minutes by car, right? We reached this sort of deserted place where, you know, there are a lot of mountains out there, and we got to go across these mountains to reach these villages where we can, you know, understand them, help them, and eventually show them what we are doing and what we can actually provide to a big number of villages out there. As soon as we climb up the mountain, there's an 86-year-old gentleman waiting for us. And he's standing out there with a bunch of, you know, a lot of his family members out there with, you know, garlands and drums and everything. And, you know, suddenly we start feeling that we came out here to help them and, you know, to put these lights. Seems like it's a big procession out here. Like, what's really going on, right? We were a bit intrigued. Like, let's not forget, we were like 17-year-olds, 18-year-olds going out there, right? And he comes out there and he puts a garland in my neck and he tells me that today is the day that my kids will actually start living. And believe me not, I was in tears. Because for me, it meant such a big deal that I spent 17 years of my life in the comfort of my home, getting all the education my parents could give me. And today, here's a big community, thousands of people in, you know, a lot of these villages out there in the tribal belts of Rajasthan, actually walking down 10 kilometers into the markets to just study under a shop light. You know, that's when I started realizing that how fortunate I ever was to really get all of this comfort, to get an institution where I could study and explore so much more, that today I can really, you know, be at a stage where I can get employed by some company and stand out there and speak to 10 people. I mean, imagine the plight of these people, right? And I think that was ever so motivating for me, that when you actually meet these people across these villages, they are the real guys who are really educating you out there and telling you that, hey, your life is not just in the four walls of your home, or it's not limited in the cities that you live in. It's a minuscule part of the population in the country, right? I mean, just as the first slide, which as ma'am said, has been showing since the past, you know, decade to a lot of people out there, the way I was looking at it is that the entire population of the United States of America, let's say about approximately 380 million, that similar population size in our very own country stays without electricity. Do we really need to see that side? And that's when I think a lot of support comes in from, you know, individuals like Dr. Shahani, who really empower the students in their very own institutions to go out there and step into these fields to really make a difference. And I feel really privileged to be one of them. And, you know, it's been transformational, the sort of projects we've done. You know, this is one of them. This is one of the old snippets that you're seeing. But today, we're just 5 homes away from reaching 11,000 homes across 7 states in the country. I think that's what means a great deal for me. Today, at the age of 17, 18, 19, we were spending our summers in these villages. Post which I went for a scholarship to Westminster and I worked out there for 9 months and I've come back. I've not had a family holiday for the past 5 years that I've been here. For the only reason that I felt that my life is not here for me to enjoy my whims and fancies, but to be with the plight of India and be with the future. I myself formed part of the future, right? I'm just 22 out here now. So I feel so much more for these people, and I think it means a great deal. And I've seen this across, you know, when we, you know, when we initiated Project Chirag, we worked with, you know, a set of colleges and different institutions across the country and worldwide as well. We've had so many institutions worldwide actually coming down, fundraising for us, coming to these villages and actually executing them. And I think that's what means a lot for us, for the only reason that when you see individuals like Dr. Shahani, I yet remember that day, ma'am, the village called Dongripara, in about end of March, I believe in 2012, when we were lighting up 100th village, you know, ma'am herself came along with us with a group of 5 faculty members to actually go into each of these houses and fix the solar lights out there. You know, it meant a great deal for us, and, you know, I can ever be so thankful to ma'am for that. So I think a lot of these things really, you know, bring that steep learning curve for us at this age, because for me personally, sitting in those 4 walls of the classroom didn't just mean, you know, that's it. That's not the stop out there. There's a lot more to life than what we actually think is. So I think, you know, it's meant a great deal to me and it's helped me all along in the future. I've been closely associated with Project Chirag and as well as a lot of projects that have rolled out from this, right? Because let's not forget, we've created a network of almost, you know, like I said, almost 11,000 homes. We've worked with panchayats and, you know, NGOs across these villages. We've leveraged that and built several other projects. So even like Project Jalvruddhi that Man just spoke about, it's exactly the same network that we're going through. Our future is to create transformational villages and not just cities of Bombay and Delhi and whatnot, right? So I think there's a bigger vision out there. I personally do feel being 22-year-old and a lot of the group that I worked with was similarly of my age, I think there's so much more potential out there. And I think with individuals of like each one of y'all in the room, I think it makes so much of a difference if you'll just push that kid out there that, hey, get out of that classroom. That's where life is. So I think if that's going to be the next story of India, I don't see why India should not become a superpower by 2020. Thank you so much. It means a lot.
So that's young Kushal for you. And I can tell you, I have 7,000 of these in HR college. But Kushal really led the way. Thank you so much, Kushal. And he was busy. And I said to him, I said, just come in for 1 hour. Because they say that the proof of the pudding lies in eating. So if you see and see how the end product is, then you... Let me now tell you a little more shocking end product. There was an uncle of mine who did M&As. Okay, he did many deals. And he used to always say, never fall in love with your deal. Okay? And so while you get involved in all these deals and actually getting very, very, you know, energetically involved and getting it done and getting it through, you shouldn't fall in love with the deal because then half the battle is lost, right? But here the half the battle is won because this young man was a faculty member at HR college and he fell in love with the deal because the deal was to make the students socially aware and he became so socially involved into the projects that he has left teaching. Of course, he comes to us as guest lecturer, but he started something even more attractive. Sorry, let me go into the next one. Okay, let's go in for that. That's his, and he's going to come up and talk to you in a minute on this.
While working in the community, what we realized was that most of the children who go to government or low-cost private schools have very poor reading levels and especially struggle with English. And currently, employability is linked to your English language. And without English, most children will find it very difficult to find gainful employment later. Leap Forward has developed content which would enable teachers who themselves aren't comfortable with English to take classes for other children and help them improve their English levels.
It's ours?
Yeah.
It's ours?
Yeah.
It's ours?
He.
Oh?
Oh.
Heart. Very nice.
So I'm going to stop here and ask Amaya to talk about it. It's called Leap Forward, and that's the NGO that he's a part of, and teaching them English, and he's taken this completely on his own. We all miss him a lot at HR College, but he's now teaching entrepreneurship at our new schools, and it's amazing to see. I told him, but sometime he's kept his life on hold, but Amaya, sometime you have to get married, so come on.
So thank you, ma'am, for giving this opportunity to speak about this venture. Ma'am, if you allow, I'm going to share a very interesting concept, and I have read this concept across 500 books almost, and it has been reoccurring. So the concept is, doddavarige barvase kodudu matra gottu, kottu matanna odisikolodilla. And it's phenomenal, right? I'll repeat. Doddavarige barvase kodudu matra gottu, kottu matanna odisikolodilla. So you got the concept, right? Yes. Some of them would have. So what we just experienced is probably experienced by 40% of our nation when the medium of instruction is English. Around 200 million kids go to regional medium schools. Unfortunately, in our country, if I want to become a doctor, engineer, or pursue any professional education, medium of instruction is going to be English. it is wrong to assume that they were not able, they cannot understand intellectual concept, but only language is creating that barrier. So two things will happen. Either they take up a medicine school and they would feel as you felt 2-3 seconds back, or they would say that English hai nahi jamega, let's not do it. That bothers us to a very great extent. We feel that he should, if he wants to become a doctor, English shouldn't be a problem which stops him from becoming that. The second driver of what drives us to kind of do this work is this device. This device has reached every rural part of our nation. In years to come, internet will become free. It has started and it will become free. Now imagine that rural kid would have a device with which he can have access to internet. It will be free, but without English, he will just watch some videos on YouTube, watch some movies and listen to songs. We all know that internet has great power, but English will stop him from achieving that. So we are trying to solve this problem. We have created a pedagogy where you need not know English to teach English. So what happens is, even a Kamwali bhai at my house can become equally good English teacher without even speaking a single word. What it is could be discussed later, but as ma'am said, we were trying this in our college. We were trying it as a small project. And somewhere as a faculty, what was bothering me was I constantly asked these students to push themselves, live the dream which they want to. And I was asking myself that whether I'm eligible to talk such things, whether I am pushing myself to achieve things which are bothering me. And that's when ma'am encouraged to say that initially do it part-time. And then when you feel it's the right time, you move on and put a dent and then come back, because then you'll be more confident in telling people, because you have done it, you have lived that particular opportunity which you have got. So the organization is Leap Forward. We can talk about it later also. But thank you so much, ma'am, for allowing me to kind of share this story with everyone here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Sorry, I keep dropping that. So you've just had this privilege of seeing a student who was impacted by the teacher, and the teacher got impacted himself, and he's also started something that he can now come and talk to about in the classes. So we talked about dream, we talked about discovering how young people can get socially impact, can make a social impact. Now let's talk about the thing that we are most excited about, is how do we disrupt? How do we disrupt a class? I'm sure a lot of you must have read this book, because this was one of the first books that came out. And when we talked about disrupting, and let me tell you, how many teachers here are from IB schools? Can I ask? Okay, let me tell you a real life story. I was sitting in my room again, early 1990s, as a first-time principal, and our admissions take place in the month of June, and we are oversubscribed. You know, all colleges in Mumbai are oversubscribed. We get about 40,000 applications for 800 seats. This is the University of Mumbai's ratios. And a young student walks into my office 1.5 months later, on the 11th or 12th of July, and says to me, I want admission in your college. And I tell him, young man, you've come 1.5 months later after the admissions are over. You're showing me a certificate which makes no sense to me. What are you going to contribute to my college that I should take you at this stage? And he very confidently tells me, independent thinking. I'd never heard that answer from any student of mine in so many years. And I saw that certificate, it says International Baccalaureate. I had no clue what that was. It was the first batch of UWC Pune student who had walked into my office. The first year when IB was introduced in India. I got very interested. I immediately found out from the office if there were any withdrawals, and there was, and I called him and I said, here's your admission, please come here, I'm really impressed with you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the end of peace in my college. He questioned every teacher, including a math teacher on her formula. Can you believe it? What a chaos there was in my college. Finally, I had to tell him, the teachers would say, if he's sitting in the class, we are not going in. So IB teachers, please beware of us, the university, colleges, are not yet prepared for taking all your smart students. So we are trying to disrupt and create an IB of higher education for all your young and all our bright CBSE, ISC, A-levels and these students. So that's when I got interested in the IB. And the next I knew was I got an invitation from Singapore to say that could I be on their regional board. Then those days they used to have regional boards. From regional board, I got moved on to the IB international board. And then the next I knew was I became vice president of IBO worldwide. And for 10 years, I was with the IB. And it was one of the most interesting things that, I feel that IB really changed my life because it was a great philosophy. Let me tell you, I worked very hard to bring the IB to India, but hoping that it'll go into the municipal schools, because in the US, it's in the public schools, and I thought that in the municipal schools, we'll be able to teach the IB philosophy. You can even teach Marathi through the IB philosophy. But it didn't work. Most of the schools that have taken up are for those who are very privileged, but I'm glad that a lot of them get an opportunity to be exposed to this great philosophy. So, I think creative destruction, that's what... Now I don't know where have we gone wrong here. We need to take this off. Sorry. The Economist has talked about it, that all universities must reinvent themselves and come for creative, look at creativity and innovation. One person who at the center, even today, besides, of course, the Prime Minister, who inspires us to be disruptive, is this young man. This is Amitabh Kant.
Until India doesn't become the most disruptive nation in the world, India must use, can never grow without technology and innovation, and India's present startup ecosystem enables it to disrupt the entire world. And we must become the most disruptive nation in the world and leapfrog.
So Mr. Amitabh Kant was talking to a large audience in Delhi, and this is what he said. And I think today the education system has to be disruptive. And so I'm happy to say that we've been a part of this entire new conglomerate of institutions that we have started. As you can see, we have brought the campuses into the corporate world. We have the Indian School of Design and Innovation. We have the Indian School of Design, Innovation and WPP, Communication, and now the Indian School of Management and Entrepreneurship. You know, my students in HR college said, ma'am, please don't leave us and don't go anywhere. And I said, look, you graduate, all of you leave and go. Let me graduate now and let me go into somewhere where my heart is taking me. And I have to say, everything that I've been wanting to do, how I wanted to bring in the skills, how I wanted to do things differently, I wanted all those elephants that I wanted to make them dance, the academia industry, connect, bringing young people to do things outside the box, we've been able to do. And I'm happy to say that Indian School of Design and Innovation was the first school in India to partner with and follow the national agenda by becoming a partner of the Make in India. And today we are the lead partner for Make in India. And I think now the Prime Minister will soon be saying, he has been saying, Make in India, Startup in India, Skill in India, and hopefully very soon Design in India. This was our design school. We feel that the design school for the future. We have tied up with Parsons, but it's a very different model. It's not an import model where we are giving any degrees from Parsons. It's a kind of an academic mentorship model where we get the Parsons to mentor us for giving us good faculty training and even share their curriculum with us. But we are developing our own localized curriculum. We are developing our... Every faculty is Indian-born and Indian-grown in our colleges. And I think they are doing amazing things. Just to give you an example, we started a course in Mumbai in our design school called Bombay in Bits. Because Bombay is in bits. You go out and the train station looks so different from the bus station, and then you go into a, this restaurant looks so different from an Udipi restaurant, so it's in bits. New York has now adopted, Parsons has adopted this course of ours, and it calls it New York in Bits. So I think there's a great synergy between these institutions and the school is coming up. The next was when I met Sir Martin Sorrell. If any of you know who he is, it's WPP Group of Companies, 63 advertising, media, and communication companies under this one man. I meet him on a flight, and we exchange cards. I knew him. He's Sir Martin Sorrell, but he didn't know me, so he took my card, and he said, "You're a dean of a college, then you're to blame." And I said, "Why is that?" And he says, because 1.3 billion in this country, and they are not getting jobs. So I said, "Sir Martin, you are to blame because industry has not tied hands with academia to produce the right talent." And instantly, he started the WPP School of Communication. All the faculty are from these companies. They give the internships. And these young students are already have been cited and said, talent is the most important thing, and these young people are going into that. And finally, this year, we started the Indian School of Management and Entrepreneurship, the postgraduate program, the undergraduate program. And why is it management and entrepreneurship? Because you want, how many of you can tell me, what is Bill Gates, a manager or an entrepreneur? What is he? Bill Gates? Yes. He's a successful manager also. Great. Very super answer. I wish I had, you know, in class I have chocolates and I throw them at this. But ma'am, you'll take it from here. Thank you so much. And share it one with me too. So that's it, the manager. But what's Mark Zuckerberg? Manager or an entrepreneur? Yes, and he's not a manager. Ma'am, can you teach in my college, please? Please come, because you know it all. It's so so wonderfully said that, you know, he started it. He's an entrepreneur, but he management skills are not everybody's. He was creative. He didn't know how to handle his organization. So his, do you know the name of his CEO who manages the organization? Sheryl Sandberg, that's it. And I think that's a great combination. So I think both the skills are different, management skills and entrepreneurship. But we need both. To start up, yes, am I right? Because you all teach entrepreneurship, am I right? Okay. So he teaches entrepreneurship. So you need managers with an entrepreneurial mindset. And that's called something. When in companies you become entrepreneurial, what's it called? Intrapreneurship. And when you actually start your own business, it's entrepreneurship. But you need managerial skills after you become an entrepreneur. So we've got our ISME, you know, motto is to have inspired in emergent social impact, as we've always done, managerial skills and this. I think it's interesting to see that because we are a design communication and a management school, we use this multidisciplinary. Our management students have studios, design students have management classes. So let me tell you one example. And our students have sat with us and created the curriculum. So when they were creating sessions for studios, we said, what kind of studios would you want in management? They talked about research, they talked about creative writing, they talked about all that. Friday, gap was empty. And one student stands up and says, TGIF. And I said, young man, I'm not going to be mixing bar drinks over here. It's not, thank God, it's Friday. He said, ma'am, I didn't mean that. What I meant was, this is an 18-year-old who stands up and tells me. What I meant was TGIF, thank God it's flipped. On that day, it will be a flipped classroom when we will teach and you will listen. And we've had two such sessions, one on Brexit and one on GST recently. And the way they taught us GST, even I wouldn't be able to do it. That's how we are disrupting. We were very fortunate. We had Amitabh Kant, who came to inaugurate our schools. And just to tell you, as I said again, if Uber can have the largest taxi service without owning taxis, if Facebook can actually reach millions without creating content, if Alibaba can have the largest retail space without creating warehouses, why should ISME, ISDI, and WPP create a university when we can use the server of the University of Mumbai? All our students do BCom and BA through distance learning, which we teach them, but then they're learning design, communication, management, and entrepreneurship with us. So they're getting a 240-credit course in 1 year, 120 with the University of Mumbai, 120 with us. And that's why it's so different. And see, Mr. Amitabh Kant, he got so taken in by the technology. We are very happy to have the latest technology in our design and all our courses. You can see the skill and aptitude growing. You can see how we've created ideation environments. It's very multidisciplinary. There's a lot of collaboration and teamwork, focus and determination, meeting cultures from all over the world, having industry leaders, learning through travel and experience, unique associations with various universities, solving real-life problems and having the best faculty. But I think what's more interesting is very recently we've been acknowledged by the government of Maharashtra to become the MSSDC for community research. So we are part of the skills, and these women come on a Saturday and learn everything and use the same facilities which students use at other times of the day. So our campus is within the corporates. We have 109 corporates around us, and we are right in the center. I'm making elevator pitches every time. I have a Morgan Stanley managing director with me. I have somebody else going in. Then they say, what are you doing here? Because they know I'm at HR college. So I said, come along and see what we are doing. And they're very excited about it. So we've also housed TAI, which is the Indus Entrepreneurs in our. So these are some of the companies who are working with all our schools, some of the associations that we have with these colleges. And the most interesting thing that has started happening here, everybody in IIMs talks about taking our classrooms to the boardrooms. We reversed that, and we now have boardrooms in the classrooms. Eureka Forbes held its board meeting in the classroom with our students around. They don't do the statutory part, because that's supposed to be confidential. We gave them a separate room for that. But when they were doing presentations on the company, the students were watching. Colgate will be doing its board meeting on 5th December. Many companies are now finding the design, communication, atmosphere very, very. They sit in closed boardrooms. They don't get inspired. They see schools and entrepreneurs and young people. They get inspired. We were very fortunate, just day before yesterday, we had 21 CFOs under one roof. And they came here because their annual meeting was to be held. They were going to hold it in four seasons. And we told them, you'll never get inspired in four seasons. Come to 100 seasons that are happening here. And they came here for a meeting. This was the most amazing thing, where Michael Kasparovich came and he did management lessons from a cricket field. And you know that class, it was packed because you know how crazy cricket is religion. We also teach different ways, it's all hands-on. We have these young students, you can see the lion behind because that's been installed in our college. But the most interesting part is, I think in schools you all teach music, but we forget about it in the colleges. So we've now got hobby sessions, and we were very happy to have, we have Vilayat Khan's son, Hidayat Khan, teaching a bit of classical music, a bit of pop. We've got Shamak Dava coming in, but doing different things. But at the end of the year, the students have to perform. if they do not, and they must see that the hall is full. If the hall is not full, they don't get marks. Because they are not good, that means, right? So we're doing these different things. So that's what it is, and hopefully graduating a lot of young students from our colleges. And I would say with that, you be the judge whether we help them to make the elephants dance. Let's see this last one. I think the last video is not coming up, maybe. I don't think you can hear the sound, but I think you can see. I think this is just what I wanted to say. Let's hope all of you and us together can make, let's not keep education, let's not bring our past into the future, let's bring the future into the present. Let's make all the elephants of regulation, universities dance, and let's bring out such young, lovely students who can actually make a difference too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sane. It was inspirational for all of you to listen. And I'm sure we share your belief that the progress in the entire education culture is to bring about a big social change. May I have the pleasure of inviting Dr. Vasumathi Badrinathan here to honor the speakers and the wonderful, wonderful social entrepreneurs here. So put your hands together for the entire team, Kushal and Amanya. So you are an inspiration to all of us. And for the most wonderful educator here, ma'am, so we are sure we'll follow your footsteps. Thank you, Dr. Vasumathi.